So, just first I have one question to you. Did someone see the entire movie, Blueberry? Okay. And did someone already see some visionary extract of Blueberry on YouTube or whatever? The idea here is, I'm not presenting the whole movie, it's a picture of 12 and 10 minutes, but the movie climax, let's say, is ayahuasca ceremony, but in the context of a Western, that's a bit special. Let me explain. I wanted, you know, in a good Western, at the end of a Western, you have a jewel. So because this film implies the shamanic realms, the ayahuasca, the final duel between the two opponents will be through ayahuasca. So of course, is something that anyone doesn't want to happen ever. Okay, it's a license I took to go on telling the story and to spread the word and to put some medicine in the form. And I thought also it was interesting because, you know, in a regular Western, you have two characters that are facing each other, and the one who is willing to win the duel or kill the other is the one, of course, where you have empathy. I mean, in general, it's a hero, even if it's spaghetti Western, even. But basically, a duel with the gun is the guy who draws the fastest, you know? So I was thinking that what we experience through a duel, even in the look and the person and our decision to be with one or the other one, it's not about that, it's about who they are. And ayahuasca reveals who you are. And this who you are is going to be confronted, the truth between the character and all that. It's finally this duel is going to be just a confrontation of two natures of the character. So that was my idea for the scene, to finally have this duel, a true, deep duel. That's the scene I'm gonna show you. What you should know if you haven't seen the film, I will tell you very little, and I will do it through, I go through the scene. But it's interesting if you see the scene out of the context of the film. Of course, it's difficult to see some of the detail that refer to the part of the story. That's why I'm gonna point. But also, it's interesting. At first, I proposed Howard to do, oh, let's do that. We talk about that scene because basically, you know, you give everything when you do the scene and you keep the mystery in it. But the film is now also 10 years old, and let's forget about the mystery and let's exchange about it. So at least I can give you clues of what I, you know, which never had that, nobody had that before, you know, you just experience the scene. So this, I will give you the guideline of the scene, the way I conceive it, or what is for me happening in a certain way. So you won't ask yourself a question. You know, basically, you will basically feel what it is there, and you won't have the mind, you know, trying to analyze what is happening, and more being into the process of the experience itself. Finally, maybe if you know a little more about the scene. So that's what I'm going to do. And the filmmaker is going to tell the story, you're going to see. But what you're going to see is not really what I'm going to tell. So first, it's happening in a special place. A place, actually, I think now, looking back to that scene some years after, today I would have set up a ceremony with mummies and dead bodies, stuff like that. So it's not like it's a sacred place, you know. Final confrontation has to come in that place. So that's why you're going to see some of these elements. So basically, the hero, Mike Blueberry, played by Vincent Cassel, is going to drink. He's with Rooney, the healer, and played by Tamara Morrison. And the healer knows what's going to happen. He knows he has to step back, but he wants to help his friend. So basically, he's going to give him ayahuasca for the second time in the movie in his life, actually, poor guy. he's like me the second time with Guillermo. So he's going to give him ayahuasca, and he's going to guide him to put him open well with Mariachi. Okay? So that's actually what a true healer does. And when he's in the spiritual realm, you'll see at one moment the face of another healer, Guillermo, actually, that is in the film, the father of Funi, who is dead. But anyway, he take him to a state. And when he's at that state, the other guy comes. Shit's gonna happen. So the other guy is also under ayahuasca, and then the duel begins. So the duel is the first maelstrom of two people, like, knowing they have to confront them. So it's actually, you can view it in two different ways. I always, my heart balance into those two dimensions. The first is truly, black magic, in a certain way, because it's when you have a confrontation and you don't heal someone and you want to use the medicine to do bad or to harm, in a certain way, that's something. But also there was another lecture to the film that always kept somewhere, I never talk about it, but for me, the both are the same person, and the film, the experience itself is part of your personality. So you can have that in a white corner of the intention. Anyway, so they are projected into the void, and the void is dark. So Michael Madsen, who played Blount, the opponent, they have in the past, they had a drama that linked their existence. A drama when they were younger, Mike was, 18 years old, something like that, 20 years or 15, I don't remember. But anyway, he was going to see a girl he was in love, and she was a whore, and they fight for her. And in his memory and what's happened in the confusion of that scene where Blount, for Mike, Blount killed her. This trauma that is within for his life, and in his memory, in his mind, is what's happened is that guy killer. Okay. So what does Blount in the realm is to bring back a kind of a different version of what's happening, in order to push him to the abyss of guilt. It was interesting for me to also, and I find in ayahuasca, guilt is the most terrifying energy that you can confront with, because there is nothing you can do with it apart. It's always win. If you don't hold it, it's always win. Because it's the past, it's something you can't change. So we have to completely accept the energy of what's happened in order that it doesn't hold you and drag you down. It's maybe personal, but I had that teaching when I was there. So I wanted to have that journey. So basically, you'll see a drawing down with guilt. And the shaman in the experience, the healer, Rumi, is stepping back, because the setup is that the two persons have a meeting. So he step back. It doesn't help one or the other, he step back. But the idea is, if you need it, if you have help in your life, it's sometimes also things you have just built up yourself because of the others, the relation you have, someone wants. You don't do things for people to help you, but maybe one day you need help, somebody will help you, and somebody that you have done something, even if you have done things not to wait for something in return, which is possible. So you will have somebody, actually, Juliette Lewis coming. I won't tell you the story, but basically, that's their story between them, and she's here, and she will come there. So that's an external help. That's something that you have set up as a person. You see what I mean? Is Mike is not alone. He's alone, but he has links, and that links comes at that moment. But the first link is like when you see somebody in that state is almost dead, they're lying on the ground. The first thing is as you have distress, you know, you're like crying because somebody's leaving, like you can have if we are losing someone, you know. We are in our pain, but that the realm of the person is, that's not a good energy. So I want you also to manifest that. Well, that's not one thing. I always say it's very difficult when somebody is dying or dead or just dead or whatever, how you be very near the person, you know, to be really helpful and not dragging or perturbating his soul, you know, if it's right to be, you know, to have emotions, but be careful of that. So I put that in the scene. Then at this point you'll see a turning where to resolve the problem you have, like it's a bit the dimension, the quick psychoanalysis you can have also with ayahuasca gives you another insight of a memory. It means when you see something that you have an opinion on it and then the plans of the state of consciousness show you another angle, you know, on the situation, then the important thing, I guess, and that's, I'm sure that many people have experienced it with the ayahuasca, is like you touch back the emotion, the original emotion you had, and unless you don't have relive again that emotion, you have the energy still in you. So you have to go through that demon world and find this emotion, and then you're starting to liberate the energy which is associated with the drama. So that there is a scene where now our two guys are really deep into like almost dying, you know, flirting with on the edge of death. And suddenly you see, so by that emotion, the hero can reconnect to spiritual forces manifested in that we drive into the following journey. And now our two guys are going, it's like, you know, the variation is getting higher, and this is a big one. I mean, it's getting higher. So one is, you know, why don't we go somewhere? But our hero then, if I remember, then they start to almost, you know, go through the information. What I wanted to make is go through the information that you have in your life, that they become almost archetypal energy. You know, it's memory living, it's energy, what you are composed of different energies now you really dissolve in the race. So now the hero is asking for help. Actually, the duel is finished. You know, I spoiled it, but anyway, the duel is finished. And now he asks for help. So when you ask for help, a healer, maybe a healer doesn't help you if you don't ask for help in a way or another. You know, always on the gap of if you identify a strong problem, you always have to ask him to help you, because sometimes the healer will give a lot of energy to do so. So he has to be sure that you want it, as you want to do your part of the journey. So basically, Mike asks Rudy to help him. And then of course it's metaphoric, but I wanted to express the way where on that stage to help somebody that almost the soul is leaving the body is by the inside. I mean that the healer has to by the inside of himself, by the internal connection and consciousness into the cell, enter the body, and then it could bring back or link his energy by that stage, which so we can manifest that stage, link his energy to the flying soul of the hero and drag him back in his body, and that will be the end of the scene. And we'll talk after that. So I hope you see part of the question.
dead soul. You're not welcome here.
Why do you say that? You're so lucky that I owe you so very much, little boy. I was in many shapes before I was released, and I see why I'm here now, to bring you with me. I see why we met the first time. To come here, in this world.
Thank you.
The memory I have of that scene, which is for me really a great memory, is when I was at the French premiere of the film. It was a big release, it was the biggest theater in Paris. All the French cinema, the screen was like double the size of the room and with the sound. And I was sitting in the central with Guillermo and having the guy near, you know, the energy is getting higher. So at one moment I was like, really, oh my God, you know, I should not see that again. So anyway, there is one thing I wanted to say, and people ask me always about the color. You know, why in Blueberry I did that monochromic, visually dimension, which is very far from the truth of ayahuasca, which is very vivid color. I did it, I think now, with the time, I would do it differently. I would put the vivid color. But every time we try it in that period, it was too far from the aesthetic of the film. You know, it was difficult to allow such a journey into the vision, so different visually than what with the film was more Western, monochrome. So, but that's true in a certain way that the experience. It's, I always say it's almost a documentary film. That part of the film is a documentary. I mean, the intensity of ayahuasca, of course, is not always like that, but it could be that level. It could reach, it happens. If I went crazy and I spent years to do, 7 years to that film, it's like really, I mean, for me, it was really something as crazy as that. But the color. So next time the color and the 3D. That would be. So if anyone has some millions, I'm happy every day to stop every film, you know, and only do a ayahuasca sequence. You know, it'll be a pleasure. At the moment, I haven't find anybody. So every time I say, if you know, I'm missing. Yeah, but it's. Yeah, exactly. Why not? But it's a big one. It's, I mean, it costs a lot, this. You know, to do that ceremony, it's that sequence, let's say. Of course, you have to build the set. Imagine now you have even not actors, but you have crane shots, you're very complex into light and crane and stuff. And then when you go to special effect, you have animation that was like, for all the vision of the film and the different special effects, mainly you have seen like one of the biggest part of what was the work, 60% of the, 70% of the crew of special effects were working on that scene. It was 40% for 2 years, you know, and big equipment. So that the reason also, you know, I had the chance to have the opportunity of a lifetime to have a big budget and to put that, and normally it doesn't go. Mystical film, you know, experiential film, and reading of the system, entertaining system and money. It doesn't work. That was like a window that was there, and I never had since. And you see that I did also the vision in another world, but in another world, you don't have spirits because just it's too expensive to make. So you have to do it another way, even if it's even. In a certain sense, even more true to the nature of the experience. So yeah, for me, it's the most interesting piece of cinema I've done. Because, I always say that maybe Blueberry is not the, I've done more coherent film or more, better film in a way, that are more efficient in one direction. But what contained that movie and that sequence is for me the best thing I've done. With another movie, a short movie about actually the Shi people that I really love, and you can find it on YouTube, of course. It's YouTube quality, but because I shot that in 35mm black and white negative film stock, which is in cinema really beautiful. And it's called Passion de Kawinuni, which we won't remember. So it's called, you Google my name, and you Google the 8, the number, because it was a film for United Nations made of 8 films, and I did one of the films I did with Shi people, it's more a social film, but I think for the Shi people or the medicine somewhere, it's a piece of that there is no visions, but you are really with the Indians and Kurandera, and it's something that I it's a sad film, but I think it's a great it's another piece I like, I prefer. Anyway. Having said that, if you have, I think we don't have a lot of time, but if you have any question, another one question.
Did any of the actors taste the medicine?
Yeah, Vasson. Yeah, Vasson, yeah, of course. He had to. But I didn't want, actually he didn't ask for it, but I really not was not so keen that Michael Madsen drink. Not sure what kind of, you know, not sure, but what we did on the shoot, actually one time on the shoot where the sequence, if you see the film, it's a waterfall, the mountains, it was an amazing location in, I think it was in Chihuahua, in a natural reserve, and we were in a lodge, and there was Guillermo as well. And so at night, we were filming session, and at night we were doing real session with the. And of course, Timora Morrison tries it. So it was such really an adventure, because you have session at night, and then the next day you're filming session, you improvise. So it was a magical moment. But yes, they are. And the special effect guys, different.
In Avatar, and I wanted to ask you, in the scene in Avatar, the main character, in order to make the link with Awa, the mother of the hearth there, you need to drink the brew. And this scene and the final version of Avatar has been cut. And I was curious to know if you know why Cameron had cut this kind of scene, maybe 3-4 minutes, and it's like an ayahuasca session where the main character, before becoming an avatar, needs to drink it in order to become linked with. So I wanted to know if you know if Cameron, why he cut this scene in the movie.
No, I know that there is a cut scene that you see in the DVD special edition where you see a visionary sequence. I didn't get it. Actually, I can tell you a little story about Avatar. I was landing in Lima when my visual supervisor of special effects of Blueberry told me that John Lando and Jim Cameron wanted to hire the company to make for Avatar a visionary sequence because they saw Blueberry. So. Cameron Sobubri, and then the company said, yeah, but this sequence is really Jan's work, so he has to be associated. So I wasn't going to the jungle, I knew about the project of Avatar, and I was like, they offered to direct, let's say, a small sequence of visionary. So I was really excited. And then later, they decided not to finish it. I think there is one main problem, it was the length of the film. But I tell you, there was another sequence I was up to do. They asked MacGuff to do, and they, you know, and MacGuff wanted me to direct it. I didn't have a direct contact with Cameron, but the moment the Jake connect to the, you know, with the to the plants, and normally that was a visionary scene instead, where you know when he's listening to the sound of the ancestor, there was a visionary scene written that I've read where the planned world showed to Jake what future could be the future where the humans have taken the planet and it is a disaster. And that was a key scene in order to make Jack move, you know, for the Navy and change the paradigm. So those scenes has disappeared from even the shoot, you know what I mean? It's like through the process you relegate. And I think one of the reasons is, and also it was a very humble lesson for me as a filmmaker. I mean, sometimes it's better not to translate the true, you know, the true experience, but to make the film by a metaphor itself, an ayahuasca ceremony, if you follow me. So it means, without drinking, you drink ayahuasca when you see Avatar, but you follow it in directly, and the film is a big success, and everybody wants to be with the Navy, and the Navy are the indigenous people, you know. And so it was a lesson, you know, and like I said, yeah, I missed my goal, you know. I love the scene I've done, I love the film I've done, but the guy is more clever. He's finally, I've done enough to not need to have the pure, real scene in order to do so. And then you open the film to much more audience. Maybe I'm more, you know, art school kind of determination. I want to do the pure thing. And it doesn't matter if half of the people won't like the scene. I think that's true to the story and the subject and that. So the other interesting thing is definitely don't have any doubts that Avatar is an ayahuasca movie, because if you take the DVD of the cut scenes, you know, in the bonus DVD, you have two scenes. One is the ceremony where he drinks something and he's been hit by some kind of scorpion, you know. So it means you need two ingredients to have the effect of the blue. Shakuna would be maybe the scorpion, I don't know, and the blue would be the other, like we had ayahuasca and Shakuna. So it's an encoding really of the two, the element of the blue. And definitely if you have it, again, you may have some doubts, you just look to the scene where I don't remember his name, but the general, like the bad guy with the scar, you know, when you come and you say, welcome to Texas, you know, to the guy, we're not in Texas anymore. That line also, it's okay. But basically, there is a cut scene when he takes, you know, this metal plate like soldier up around the neck. That's sharp. I mean, you have the scene in the DVD, it's sharp. It's not that sharp. And he takes the plate in the hand and say, you have all on you your death metal ticket, DMT. Why he has kept that? Because he doesn't want any trouble. Because when you do a 200 million movie, at the last moment you think, okay, if too much people decode it too early in the film, they're going to jump to drug movie, it's based on ayahuasca, and then it can kill the distribution. And it's 200 million. So at one moment, you say, I have enough that people will dig, like I dig, or I knew, but some of them will dig, and you see, it's an ayahuasca movie, Avatar. So there is reason, and there is a reason for the French guy to push it too far, but it was not a success before. You know, it's too far. So it was a lesson for me. Thank you.